Albert and Alan Hughes are now perhaps not as well known to cinema fans. But in the early 90s, the partnership of the Hughes brothers was the promise of bold, impactful work that pulled no punches. Their career started early as they cut their teeth at a young age on music videos for hip-hop legend Tupac Shakur. At 20, the Hughes brothers would grab attention almost immediately with their feature film debut, Menace to Society, an impactful and authentic look at gang culture in Los Angeles. As well as being a hit with audiences, the film displayed a maturity, visual confidence, and insight that was beyond their years.
Do you care whether you live or die?
I don't know.
Undeterred by the fear of the sophomore slump, the Hughes brothers would up the ante on their follow-up by creating an epic saga in the tradition of American auteurs such as Martin Scorsese, Francis Ford Coppola, and Oliver Stone to chronicle a significant chapter in African-American life with the highly ambitious Dead Presidents. Dead Presidents sees the Hughes brothers bring back Menace to Society's Lorenz Tate, who plays Anthony. Anthony is a wide-eyed dreamer who enlists into Vietnam as a way to leave the limited surroundings of the East Bronx in order to see the world. Spanning from the late 60s to the early 70s, the film transcends its war movie trappings to encompass life and death, as well as crime and punishment, as we watch Anthony's rapid transition from boyhood into manhood as he struggles to find his place in an ever-changing and hostile America.
I think y'all was some goddamn fools going over there fighting that white man's war. That's right. What you got when you get back here, huh? Not a goddamn thing.
In 1991, Columbia Pictures introduced you to an extraordinary new filmmaker and an unforgettable new vision. The director was 23-year-old John Singleton. The film, Boys in the Hood.
In the early 90s, there would be a sudden change in Hollywood studios and a sudden rise in interest in black filmmakers. Perhaps this interest had stemmed from the rise in the popularity and profitability of hip-hop music, which was crossing over into white suburbia. This interest was also piqued by the success of the inimitable Spike Lee. Lee's early films, such as She's Gotta Have It, School Days, and Do the Right Thing in particular, which was nominated for the Palme d'Or at Cannes, would prove that not only could black films attract critical acclaim, but also could bring in audiences, and therefore, the money.
When did you people start getting so interested in black folks?
The interest in black audiences in Hollywood was nothing new, however. In the early 70s, just like Spike Lee had done in the 90s, Melvin Van Peebles' independently financed Sweet Sweetback's Badass song demonstrated there was money to be made in films aimed at black audiences. Out of this came the genre known as blaxploitation.
You ain't so black.
And you ain't so white, baby.
For the first time in American film, black audiences would see numerous depictions of black actors and actresses as heroes fighting crime and standing up to authority. There would be a slew of iconic films such as Shaft, Black Caesar, Superfly, Foxy Brown, and Cleopatra Jones. The genre would prove so popular and profitable that even the Bond franchise got in on the act with 1973's Live and Let Die.
Keep your hands up, honky.
All of this success would come at a cost, however. Very few films were actually made by black directors, but more importantly, the films would be criticized for being empty escapism at a time where black people were not treated as equally as their powerful screen alter egos, and the stereotypes of criminals, pimps, and prostitutes did little to depict a more progressive identity. Flash forward to the 90s, and young black filmmakers such as John Singleton with Boys in the Hood, Matty Rich with Straight Out of Brooklyn, and the Hughes brothers would maintain creative control of their films by not only writing and directing, but also insisting on final cut and little studio interference. Their work would be a chance to go beyond the stereotypes of blaxploitation and delve deeper into the African-American experience. Once again, however, their success created higher demand for similar product, resulting in a sea of so-called hood movies that created a second wave of stereotypes with drug dealers, gangbangers and criminals, and ultimately, a new era of blaxploitation. The genre had become so prolific and predictable that by the mid-90s, it had become ripe for parody.
This ain't your baby! This ain't your baby!
Some shit.
With Dead Presidents, the Hughes brothers would push black cinema out of its restrictive genre and into the realm of classic cinema, depicting the world of its African-American protagonist in a way that hadn't been seen in a mainstream Hollywood movie before, especially with such veracity. At its best, cinema is a mirror that reflects life. In the coming of age genre in particular, we see the rites of passage that, for better or worse, enlighten our screen alter egos and steer them into adulthood. In the case of Hollywood cinema, the African-American experience was traditionally very limited in regards to its depiction of everyday life. It was a long-standing tradition in Hollywood for black actors to be relegated to the sidelines in supporting roles. Over the years, actors such as Sidney Poitier, Richard Pryor, and Eddie Murphy would be the exception and would normally be the isolated black figure in a white world. In regards to the coming-of-age genre, there was very little reflecting black childhood, adolescence, or teenage life. 1975's Cooley High would sneak through during the blaxploitation cycle. Then, Charles Burnett's small arthouse gem, Killer of Sheep, would be a captivating take on childhood from a working-class black perspective. But it wouldn't be until the 90s where movies such as House Party and Boys in the Hood, as well as Spike Lee's Crooklyn, would bring these portrayals to the screen in the same way as such classics as Diner and Stand By Me. What makes Dead President so notable is that it strips away the sensationalism and stereotypes of the hood genre to tell a universally American story beyond the race and class boundaries. The protagonist, Anthony, is not an exceptional person. He's an everyman trying to get his piece of the American dream.
I want to do something else. I don't want to go to college. I'm sick of school. Man, I don't know why everybody got this strange look on their face. It's my life.
Yeah, it's your life.
Throughout the film, we see all of the staples of American life, which simply had not been depicted so extensively with a black character in the lead. We see him working a milk round, graduating high school, driving for the first time, losing his virginity, going to war, experiencing death, and becoming a father. It's hard to think of an example of when a black protagonist has been portrayed with such a wide gamut of experiences that are equal to what we would expect from a traditional Hollywood movie. And when it comes to cinematic tradition, the Hughes brothers followed in the footsteps of the best. Good artists borrow, great artists steal, or so the saying goes. Francis Ford Coppola also said something similar, stating that nothing can be stolen. He said filmmakers will take what they admire and ultimately put it in their own voice. That's how filmmakers find their voice. Dead Presidents appropriates the strongest of voices in American cinema by referencing the work of Coppola, Stone, and Scorsese, the great chroniclers of 20th century American life. We see references to Goodfellas with Anthony running numbers like Henry Hill, as well as long tracking shots, and a scene that's reminiscent of the Billy Bat's death scene when Anthony attacks Cowboy. There's a small reference to Raging Bull when Anthony suspects his girlfriend of cheating on him. It's very similar to the scene where Jake LaMotta suspects Vicky of cheating on him. We see a small Godfather 2 reference when Anthony loses his job at the butcher's, which echoes when the young Vito Corleone loses his job at the bakery. And when Anthony returns home from Vietnam, we see several visual references to Scorsese's Taxi Driver, including Anthony's combat jacket and the general feeling of alienation and isolation. The section is in fact opened with a shot of a taxi and a driver that resembles Robert De Niro. The most notable and significant referencing, however, is in the Vietnam section of the film, which after years of having black characters in the background of classic Vietnam movies such as Apocalypse Now, Platoon, Full Metal Jacket, and Forrest Gump, to name but a few, Dead Presidents finally puts the African-American experience in Vietnam into the foreground.
The fuck you got there, Curtis? Something about black man go home. This isn't your war.
You get rid of that cocksucking common bullshit right now.
It would only be recently that Spike Lee's The Five Bloods would explore the role of black veterans in Vietnam, and that's 25 years after this movie. This section is predominantly influenced by the films of Oliver Stone and Francis Ford Coppola. The pre-war scenes with Anthony and his friends bring to mind the Americana of Oliver Stone's Born on the 4th of July, but it's Oliver Stone's Platoon that's also referenced through the presence of Keith David as Anthony's mentor, who was also in Platoon.
All you got to do is make it out of here. It's all gravy.
Anthony's loss of innocence is also an echo of Platoon due to the trauma of war. We also see a lot of references to Apocalypse Now, from the iconic helicopter shots to the letter montage, which reminds us of Captain Willard's voiceover and diary. The squad leader Dugan's camouflage makeup resembles Marlon Brando's Kurtz. And in the very last scene, there's a bit of ironic casting. The judge that sentences Anthony is played by none other than Martin Sheen. The use of homage and referencing is not just empty hero worship, however. The reframing of these scenes by the Hughes brothers not only gives their slice of American life the same gravitas and cinematic heritage as the films that inspired them, but also they're compensating for the lack of black representation through decades of contemporary cinema by reframing these classic scenes in their own image, in the same way that their heroes would use the influence of European and world cinema to create their own personal stories.
Because I don't think about the world, Skip. That shit don't exist to me. I don't give a fuck about anything or anyone in it. Because the minute I do, I'm a dead man out here. And you remember that shit. We'll talk about the world when we get back.
Yeah, whatever, man. I'm finna go get high.
The story of dead presidents is one of nihilism. As the opening titles roll, we see money being burned, suggesting its destructive power. As each bill burns, we see the flames engulf the core beliefs of America. The words United States and God burn away, as does an image of a working man and the eagle, the symbol of America's freedom, suggesting that all of these things are fading away. They're literally disappearing before our very eyes, as is the promise of society and money. Dead presidents, after all, is slang for dollar bills, and it's the lack of money that removes Anthony's agency as a man in the country he fought for. In a key scene, he's humiliated by Cutty, a man his girlfriend was with when he was away at war. Cutty still gives them money, and as a result, he belittles Anthony due to his inability to provide for his family. Poverty has not only taken over his neighborhood, but his life.
You can't even put food on your fucking table. Don't you ever in your fucking life bite the hand that feeds you, nigga.
In the action-packed and tense finale of the film, Anthony successfully pulls off a heist with his old army buddies and some old accomplices. Things don't go to plan, however, and the law closes in, leading to a devastating and bold ending.
Things were getting bad for me, and I had to do what I had to do to survive. Maybe it was wrong, but I certainly didn't mean for anybody to be hurt.
While Anthony makes his plea to the judge, he's shown no sympathy. His service to his country is treated with skepticism and looked on with dishonor, to the extent where the Vietnam War is not even considered a real war by the judge, who says he served in Korea. When Anthony is finally sentenced, he's sentenced to life, and we see an outpouring of rage from a man who's been betrayed by his country and stripped of his beliefs, beliefs that were promised but never fulfilled. And in the abrupt ending, we see Anthony on the cage-like prison bus, surrounded by other black men, taking one last look at the world, reminding us that in America, it can quite often be a question of black and white, but ultimately, the most important color is green, the color of money, and whether you can survive without it. So that's my take on Dead Presidents. Thanks for watching. See you next time.
My grandpa asked me one time if I care whether I live or die. Yeah, I do. Now it's too late.